In this Evaluation Center video, I'm going to show you how to install the Windows Server 2022 operating system. We start on the operating system setup screen, where we choose our language, currency, format, and input method. I'm going with the defaults, and I click Next. I then click Install Now, and that starts the installation routine. The next step is to choose which SKU or version of Windows Server 2022 I want to deploy. You can go with standard or data center. The differences are listed on a Microsoft web page, but essentially you only use data center if you need enterprise scale features involving Hyper-V virtualization or storage spaces direct. The other difference is the desktop experience versus the server core version. The default is server core. In this demo, I'm going to install the desktop experience version, as this is the one that is most similar to Windows 10 and Windows 11. I then accept the license terms for Windows Server. I then choose the custom installation option. You only choose the upgrade option if you are performing an in-place upgrade from a version such as Windows Server 2016 or Windows Server 2019. On the Where do I want to install the operating system page, I select the volume on which I wish to install the operating system. Here, I can actually choose multiple volumes, actually format partitions, and reconfigure storage. I select the default and click Next. All of the operating system files are copied across and the installation process begins. Once the installation process begins, the server will reboot several times and then you'll be asked to put in the administrator password. This is for the first administrator account, and the computer will be configured as a standalone and in the beginning. We then log in using that administrator account and password. The next step in this case is to configure networking, because I have deployed this server on a network that does not have DHCP available. To do this, I go to Network Connections. I select Network and Sharing Center. And then I select Change Adapter Settings. I right-click on Ethernet, I select Properties, I select TCP IP version 4, and I put in the IP address for the network that this adapter is connected to. There are a variety of ways that you can do this, from PowerShell and other tools, but I'm using the one that's most likely familiar to people that have used Windows 10 and 11. I click OK, I click Close. I get a network dialog that says you're connected to a new network. Are you sure about this? And that's a security feature. But what I'll do is I'll open PowerShell and I will ping a known host 1.1.1.1 and verify that this computer now has connection to the internet. The next step I'm going to take is I'm going to rename the computer. By default, the computer is assigned a random name. I select properties. I could click rename this PC, but I'm going using old muscle memory. And I'm selecting Advanced System Settings, which will bring up the Advanced System Settings dialog. I click Computer Name, I click Change, I put in the new name of the server. I click OK, and then I am told that I need to restart the computer for that name to apply. I allow the restart to occur, I log back in, and now I have installed and set up a basic version of Windows Server. In this evaluation video, I'm going to show you how to install Windows Admin Center and then perform some tasks, including checking for updates and installing a file server role. So we're starting here with Edge open, and I type in aka.ms/whack-download. And what this does is it automatically starts the download of the Windows Admin Center binaries. Now that they're downloaded, I open up the downloads folder, double click on it, and it starts the whack setup wizard. I accept the terms, I click next, I'm accepting the required diagnostic data. I want to make sure it's kept up to date when I check for updates. I review the scenarios. I am allowing it to configure Windows Server with the trusted host settings. I am allowing it to use port 443 and to generate a self-signed certificate, which is fine for a demo, but in the real world, you would actually obtain a certificate from a CA. I click Install, and it installs Windows Admin Center. I'm ready to connect, so I just select the URL here. And it automatically goes and opens Edge. The first thing it needs me to do is authenticate, so I put in my administrative credentials. I then select the server. This is the server I've just installed it on. It connects to the server, and now I see the properties of this host server. Now let's do some things with Windows Admin Center. The first thing I should have done after setting up this server is actually check for updates. I'll select updates, and I can do that through Windows Admin Center. And we see here that I have a cumulative update available. So I select all the update files, I select install updates, and in the background, Windows Admin Center applies the updates to the server, and the server restarts. I then sign back in again. After I sign back in, I open Windows Admin Center, authenticate. And now that I've authenticated, let's do some more with Windows Admin Center. For example, I can select processes. I can select a lot of different things that you would normally do through the UI, such as opening performance monitor, packet monitoring, editing the registry, and looking at processes and terminating processes. With Windows Admin Center, you can do it on the local server, or you can do it against a remote server you've connected to. The next thing I want to do is I want to install the file server role on this server. So I scroll down to roles and features, and I'm going to increase the size here. I select file and storage services, expand file size SCSI, and there I see the file server role. So I select the file server role, and then I select install. It does a check for me, and it says, right, I need to install these two services and reboot the server if it needs it. I click yes, and it starts installation. Now, it turns out that installing the file server role on Windows Server doesn't actually require a reboot. So the roles installed, I get a notification about that. And then what happens is Windows Admin Center has a new blade for me, the file and file share blade. So I can use that to go and create files and folders. So here I select the C drive, I'm creating a new folder, and that's going to host my shared folder. So I call it shared folder, you can call it anything you want. Now that I've created a folder on volume C, I can go back and select file shares. And I can create a new file share. I select the folder location, so I select that folder I just created. I click OK. I then check the name. I'm happy with shared folder. I configure the permissions here. I'm saying everyone will have read access to this folder. I click create and it's created the shared folder for me. And to verify that that exists, I can go into File Explorer and use WhackWhack localhost, and I can see the shared folder there. So here I've installed Windows Admin Center, used it to perform some tasks, including installing the file server role and configuring a file share. In this Eval Center video, you're going to see me install the server core version of Windows Server 2022. So here we select Standard Edition, and this means that we're selecting the server core version. I accept the license terms, I select the custom installation option, I select the unallocated space, the operating system files copy over, in this case to the virtual machine hard drive, the operating system restarts, and I'm asked to put in my administrator password for the first time, which is setting the administrator password. So I add the new local administrator password. Now that that's been done, I hit enter, and it loads me into sconfig. Sconfig is a menu-driven interface for managing server core. So what I'm going to do is, because there's no DHCP server on the Hyper-V network I've set up, I'm going to manually configure the IP address. I do that by selecting network settings, selecting the interface index, and then selecting set network adapter address. I say I want it to be a static address. I put in the IP address I want to configure it for. I put in the subnet mask. And I put in the default gateway. Now that that's done, I need to set the DNS server address. And here I am configuring two DNS servers on the internet. Now that that's done, I'm going to change the computer name because it's assigned a random name. So in this case, I'm calling it WS2022 Eval Core. It needs to restart the computer. The computer restarts. I sign back in. And I verified that remote management indeed is enabled for this server. In this Windows Server Eval Center video, I'm going to show you how to remotely connect to a server core machine using Windows Admin Center, and then promote that machine to a domain controller, and then join the newly configured domain. So we start here, Windows Admin Center, and I'm going to add the server core server. And I do that via IP address because at the moment it is a standalone computer. So I put in the IP address, and then I have to put the administrator account with the IP address. So IP address slash administrator, put in the password, and that allows me to connect to that server core machine. I click add, it's now in my list in Windows Admin Center. I click on eval core and it makes a remote connection to that machine. And now I'm managing that remote machine through Windows Admin Center. I come down to roles and features. I select Active Directory Domain Services. I select Install. It calculates my dependencies. And I say, yep, reboot if it's necessary, but it won't be in this case. It installs Active Directory Domain Services binary. We haven't configured Active Directory yet. We've actually got to then perform a remote PowerShell connection. We can do that through Windows Admin Center. I'll just make it a little bigger here. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to run two commands. One, provide a secure password, and then two, install ADDS Forest. And what I'm doing is I'm installing the first domain controller in a new domain called tailwindtraders.internal, and that'll be in the new forest. Now we get a whole lot of PowerShell here, but what that's done is it's gone and configured that server core machine as a domain controller in a new domain. And to check that, we can come across here and we can verify that that server core machine has rebooted and it's now asking for domain credentials, which means it's a domain controller. So we come back to Windows Admin Center, and what we're doing now is we're connecting to the host machine, the first machine we installed, which is running the desktop with a GUI. Now I'm going in and I'm using Windows Admin Center to change the IP address configuration. And I'm setting this server up now, so it's going to use that newly promoted domain controller as its DNS server. And by doing that, what I'm able to do then is take this standalone computer and join it to that brand new domain. So I'm going back to the overview page. I select edit the computer ID. I select the domain I want to join, which is tailwindtraders.internal. I then go next. It asks me for my domain administrator credentials to join the domain. I put in my password. I click save. And what happens is this computer goes and joins the domain. And then of course that requires a restart. And now I can log on to this host computer using domain credentials. So I specify Tailwind Traders administrator and I sign on. Now, because I've rebooted and I'm now logged in as another user, I'm going to have to re-add my servers. So the first one I'm going to go and re-add is my domain controller. And I can now query Active Directory because I'm now part of an AD environment. And I can select that server core domain controller. I click add. And now I can go and connect to that domain controller using Windows Admin Center. And there we are.